Okay, so welcome to this session. I'd like to introduce you to River Wolton, and she's going to be talking about the subtle art of caring, sustaining compassion in challenging times, her new book, which is just out a few days ago. I saw Windhorse Publications announced it just a few days ago. So the book asks, how do we meet and respond to climate and ecological breakdown and the intersecting crises of social and racial injustice without burning out? River's new book, Subtle Art of Caring, A Guide to Sustaining Compassion, offers creative, inspired approaches for a life in which compassion and justice for self and other are mutually sustaining. Join River as she discusses how the Brahma Viharas, together with the power of community, enable activism and contemplative practice to nourish and to support each other. Presentation will begin with a short practice, including readings from the book and a question and answer session. So, River is currently living in Derbyshire, in the Hope Valley in Derbyshire, she told me. And she completed her Dharma teacher training with Bodhi College and teaches at Gaya House in Devon and throughout the UK. She's a longtime peace activist and LGBTQ plus activist. She's a former Derbyshire poet laureate. So we may get some poetry this morning. And she co-founded Sheffield Insight Meditation. So please welcome River Wolton. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Shantigarbha, for that lovely introduction. And thank you for inviting me to the conference. It's really lovely to be here and to see everybody and be with you. I've been in several of the sessions so far and feeling very nourished and inspired and enthused and curious in mind, body, and heart, with all the wonderful presentations and practices that have been offered. I'm going to structure the session slightly differently from how I originally intended. It's going to be a little bit of, I'm going to offer a little bit of reading from the book, and then we'll go into a guided practice, and then I'll read a little bit more from the book, and then there'll be some time for your reflections, questions, discussion after all of that. And recognizing that there are many mother tongues here and people from many different countries. So please do let me know if I'm speaking too quickly or if you don't understand anything, do send me a message or unmute and let me know. Can you hear me clearly now and see me clearly enough? Great, thank you very much. Wonderful. So this book really came about through many of my own experiences of engaging with different issues and then after a while burning out, the cycles of engagement, caring, wanting to do something, and then becoming exhausted and feeling depleted. That was one of the seeds that then grew into this book. And just sort of sitting in some of the presentations and some of the wonderful offerings that have been given already at this conference, noticing again some of those different feelings, emotions, feelings in the body, the mind, heart, arising, the full spectrum. So I just wanted to open it up to you. How are you doing? How are your hearts, minds, bodies in relation to this this question that we are considering here? How do we respond compassionately in the knowledge of interdependence from a Dharma perspective? How do we respond? What emerges? How are you feeling in the light of these interconnected and profound crises and challenges that we face as beings, as human beings, as interconnected beings. If you'd like to just pop a word or a phrase into the chat, and also if you'd like to unmute and say a word or two, you're really, really welcome to do that too. And the full spectrum is welcome. Tired. Yeah, thank you. Horrific. Oh, yeah, breathing with these words as they come in and feeling if there's a resonance in your own hearts, minds, bodies. Anxiety.
Faith.
Thank you. So sad. Between grief, numbness, and gratitude. Curious, energized, and mildly overwhelmed. Challenged, hopeful. Angry and betrayed. It's also an opportunity. Despair with a flame of hope. Grateful. Often when these beautiful collective offerings come in the chat, they feel to me like they're already a kind of collective poem that we are creating together with all these different flavors and textures and images and all of these different responses. Another one, just staying in awareness of the spectrum of states and bringing compassion and gratitude to myself and others. And trying to see different perspectives. Thank you all for that generosity of your offerings. Clarity, that what else is there to do but keep finding the way to keep the heart alive and open, the ongoing challenge. Yes. So I'd like to say a little bit about how my investigations of the Brahma Viharas, these beautiful capacities, these human capacities that are in every heart, often hidden, often obscured, often feeling a long way away from us, can really support us in these times. And I'm going to screen share. So this is the title of the book, Subtle Art of Caring. It's illustrated by the artist Emma Burley, so this image of the bracken with its green, orange, red is one of her images. And the Brahma Viharas, one of the ways in which I've been most inspired to see how they connect with each other, these beautiful capacities of metta, often translated as loving kindness or friendliness, of compassion, of joy and equanimity. One of the ways that I've really been inspired is seeing how they interconnect and support each other. So this poem is a poem that I heard many years ago from one of my teachers, John Peacock. And it's a poem by a 14th century Tibetan yogi, scholar, teacher, writer called Longchenpa. Out of the soil of friendliness grows the beautiful bloom of compassion, watered by the tears of joy, sheltered beneath the cool shade of the tree of equanimity. And from this poem, we can begin to sense how this capacity for compassion, for caring, for responding as best we can to dukkha, to suffering, to unsatisfactoriness, to the unreliability of conditioned lives, really is supported by the earth in which it grows, the earth, the ground of friendliness, of metta. But it also needs, crucially, to be watered by joy, joy in all its forms, and also to be sheltered, protected by equanimity, by steadiness, by balance. So this next diagram, which is also one of Emma's art pieces, shows a little bit about how the, speaking about the intersection of the Brahma Viharas and how each of them supports each other, and how this support, when we're talking in terms of responding with care, with compassion to the crises of our world, we really need to bring in the friendliness, the soil of friendliness, the tears of joy, and the protection of equanimity. So I'm going to read a little bit from the beginning of the book. And this section begins with the word respair, R-E-S-P-A-I-R. And it's a word that has fallen out of use in English. It's a word that actually I discovered was a Scots writer coined it in the Middle Ages. And we could see this as an example of how sometimes the negative versions of words, such as despair, persist, whereas the more positive framing, such as respair, a recovery from despair, get lost. The word respair was last recorded in 1525, means fresh hope, a recovery from despair. This book aspires to offer both respair and a radical reframing. It attempts to gather resources that move against the stream of 21st century memes, the myth of eternal economic growth, the imperative of individualism and self-improvement, the pull to deny embodiment. By drawing attention to inalienable and renewable capacities, it flies in the face of late capitalism's hyper-consumerism and broken record tale of scarcity and urgency. Buy now while stocks last. Can we shift possibilities by telling a different story that subverts habits of extraction and depletion? The stories we tell and how we tell them can help navigate vulnerability and existential threats. The framework of immeasurable capacities, or Brahma Viharas, that is a central part of Buddhist philosophy, responds directly to these questions. Kindness, metta, compassion, karuna or anukampa, joy, mudita, and equanimity, upekkha, are multidimensional. They are contemplation subjects, relational practices, therapeutic tools, and pathways of absorption and insight. So here is Long Chenpa's poem again. Out of the soil of friendliness grows the beautiful bloom of compassion, watered by the tears of joy, sheltered beneath the cool shade of the tree of equanimity. These images in the poem reflect the premise that without the support of its companions, compassion, the capacity to care and respond, will not survive and thrive. Like other expressions of life, it requires certain conditions to flower. Without the nourishment and protection of friendliness, joy, and equanimity, it distorts into its near and far enemies, pity, overwhelm, disconnection, cruelty, and burnout. So I'd like to invite us into a short practice exploring these Brahma Viharas, and beginning first with pausing, so please find a comfortable place to arrange your body. That might be sitting, it might be lying back, reclining, might be lying down. Make sure you're comfortable, that you're warm enough. And before we enter into these heart qualities, these explorations of the Brahma Viharas, feels important first to consciously pause. Often this is the bit that can be missed out when we are drawn to act, drawn to respond. So you might want to take a slightly longer, deeper breath. One or two of these to consciously arrive and land. You might want to close your eyes or keep them open with a soft focus. With that deeper out breath, allowing it to release down the back of your body, lengthening the back of the neck, softening the shoulders, the backs of the arms, the hands. Breathing out with the back of the body. Letting that out breath travel all the way down to the sitting bones. Breathing out and down into the places where your body of earth rests into the body of the earth. Slowing the tempo. In the midst of our lives with all the multiple demands and to-do lists, keeping it simple, just for now. Imagining you can set down any baggage, literal, metaphorical, that you might have been carrying. Allowing your body to sink down to meet the earth, just as the earth is rising up to meet and to hold you. Letting the breath come as it wishes. The body breathing itself. And from any sense of contact with the earth, with the ground, even if it's just a minute, a moment, a micro moment here or there, tuning into this ground, imagining it, sensing it as a ground of friendliness, of warmth, of support. Tuning into the ways in which the earth unconditionally supports you. Breathing up from this warm, friendly earth. taking in whatever nourishment can be absorbed, can rise up through your body, filling it out. Knowing that sometimes when we turn towards kindness, friendliness, befriending, very usual that the opposites might arise, the arguments against it. Seeing if these two can be met, recognized, allowed, as best you can with an attitude of friendliness. Of recognition. Sometimes we might need to borrow from the softness of a blanket, the support of the seat, the cushion. Taking in the softening, the warming. And little by little, allowing what is well in this moment. A pleasant sensation, a lovely image, finding the key of what is well, what can bring uplift to the heart and mind. Even some gladness and joy. Finding the key of joy might be very simple. They come through the doorways of sound, smell, touch. Again, noticing if the objections to any gladness arise, any backdraft. Any sense of not now, not possible. And to support moving through this, you might want to put a hand on your upper chest, near your heart, a hand on the belly, and connecting with the vertical axis. Moving into the realm of caring, of the wish and of the capacity to respond to difficulty. For from the support of ground, of friendliness, of the threads, the key of joy and delight. And from knowing that you are not alone. Bringing to mind someone, some place, something in your life that is challenging at the moment. Not the most difficult. Really important as we engage with this capacity for compassion, that we know we are not alone. You might want to sense, imagine, picture yourself in a circle, many, many circles. Of beings, and of care. And within this, holding whatever is difficult, the person, the place, the experience in yourself. Turning towards this with wishes for the suffering to be held, to be alleviated, taking a seat in this vast realm, this boundless realm of caring. And sensing into how this capacity for care is moving through you, even if it's in a small, momentary, micro-momentary way. That it is like music that plays through you. Just as we breathe in the oxygen freely offered by countless other beings, tree beings, plant beings, and breathe it out to nourish others. Sensing any steadiness and balance that can come from really knowing ourselves to be held within a circle of compassion. As compassion arises and flows, in the last few moments, returning again to the ground. Really tuning in to the ground of your body on the ground of the earth. And again, the words from Longchenpa. From the soil, the ground of friendliness, grows the beautiful bloom of compassion. Watered by tears of joy, under the cool shade of the tree of equanimity. Thank you for your practice. So this, in a way, quite rapid journey through the Brahma Viharas, I hope gives a sense of the ways in which they can really interlink and support each other in the service of sustainability. And I wanted to read another story from the book, which is from the last chapter, where the chapters are pausing, befriending, enjoying. I've put joy before compassion, which is not the traditional way of doing it, but feels so important to really nourish ourselves with joy in its fullest spectrum so that compassion can be sustained. And then after enjoying, caring, and finally letting be. And with letting be, the journey of the book is very much towards interdependence and towards anatta, not self. The fluidity of self, the ways in which our fixed and contracted perceptions of self can really inhibit our capacity to care and our capacity to meet the challenges of our times. So I want to read a story about a seal. Seal pup. And I'm going to share an image as well. If I could be made co-host, then I can share the image. So this is Shoreline. I think my machine has gotten very confused. So I'll just bring that. It's not showing, so I'm going to leave that for now. At low tide, we find a seal pup lying on the rocks. A meter and a half long, it raises its head, yaps and stares at us. Google says it's usual for pups to be left on their own. Don't get too close. It's almost 2 months before grey seals come ashore to give birth on the North Sea coast. Will the mother return? Fish stocks are depleted. Perhaps she's searching for food. The white fur that encased the pup as a newborn is molting, but it's still unable to fish for itself. It's easy to break one's heart over a stranded seal pup, out of its natural element, unable to move. The compassion thought police waver between, you always want to ignore things when something must be done, and you take too much responsibility for things beyond your reach. Next day, the worried one is still in the driving seat. More Googling reveals that there are two kinds of seal in this area, grey and common. Common seals are the least common. They have different shaped heads, are smaller, their breeding season begins earlier, and pups can swim soon after birth. We've seen a common seal, probably an adolescent. Anxiety settles. I've constructed a doom-laden picture. My mind bounces into a more hopeful relationship with experience. The optimistic version of myself takes shape. Perhaps I can forget about seals for now. Reading more widely, I learn that common seals have declined by 50% since 2000 due to unknown causes. Despair worms its way back in. The depressed self comes into being. I also find researchers' blogs patiently documenting seal populations and watch a video of a seal giving birth, her rolling contractions, the slippery, pulsating newborn as it emerges, mother and pup nuzzling each other, the tide coming in, mother encouraging pup to begin swimming. There is a narrow viewpoint, contracted around and co-arising with a fixed sense of self, always lacking the full information. And there is a bigger picture. It's true that something must and can be done, but the voices of denial and despair have contracted and diminished my ability to do it. I resolve to walk the shoreline again and pay more attention, to look out for the fishing debris that can harm seals, to support charities that protect marine wildlife. So that's a little bit bringing in how our perceptions of self and the contractions around a sense of self can really inhibit us. Thank you very much for your attention and patience with the technical hitches. And I'd just like to open up now to questions, to your reflections, to your comments, and to your insights about how we sustain ourselves in these times. And thank you, Shanti Garba, for posting the poem from Long Chimpa. To unmute or wave or put something in the chat. Ratna Devi.
Hello, thank you so much, River. I loved your presentation and the meditation, and I think particularly how you're encouraging the objections, you know, both in your reading as well and in the meditation, you know, because I really do think that we can cause ourselves quite a lot of unnecessary heartache if we just assume that we should be just be in full flow of the Brahma Vihara straight away. It's such a kind way, actually. It is a manifestation of kindness to really pay attention to the other voices.
Thank you so much, Ratna Devi. There can be so much pressure and oughts about, you know, I should be more compassionate and I ought to care more, and really meeting the objections and finding our way of relating to them is so, like you say, so important. It can be so much guilt and shame that operates in this whole sphere. I'm not doing enough. There's, you know, I should do this, and a kind of you know, Mara can really get going, the inner critic, the inner judge. Someone else was waving. Anyone else? Yoga Ratna.
Hi, yeah. Thank you, River. I've actually read about 2/3 of your book so far, and I'd just like to say thank you. It's really excellent. And I'm really struck by your care. You're very thoughtful and you've experiential. So I think it's a very valuable book for how to resource ourselves and look out for things like you're talking about, the self-judging and all that kind of thing. So just a big thank you. And I think thank you for your book.
Oh, thank you, Yogaratna. Yes, it's, as Shantigarbha said, it's just come out. So I'm just in this sort of kind of slightly birthing process of it. And it's really exciting and touching to hear that you're reading it, that people are reading it, and, quite moving. I'm so glad that you found it helpful.
I think it could be I think there's a big need. I think, and there will be a bigger need for how to resource ourselves. So I think it's really timely and very valuable. So I think it deserves promoting.
Oh, bless you. Thank you. Ratna Davies got a question. Do you use IFS, internal family systems, as a method of befriending all our parts? Not specifically IFS, though I'm very interested in that, but I think those kinds of approaches can really be super helpful. Many years ago I trained as a psychotherapist and had gestalt therapy myself, and so that sort of approach I think can really be useful. And particularly, in this, we have this wonderful framework of Mara, the kind of, which, we can see in psychological terms, is the personification of a lot of internalized judgment. And that can be, our particular kind of conditions that we grew up, or it can also manifest through, through different identities that we have. So kind of internalized homophobia, internalized racism. So I think, all of this, I think, can, the Dharma teachings, so it can be so valuable in their intersection with psychological approaches. All of this is, so valuable in these times when we need to draw on all resources and the way that they kind of intersect with each other. Karuna Vacha.
Yeah, hi River, and thank you. I'm really looking forward to reading your book. The little bits so far are they're lovely, great. And yeah, I can see why it's a very valuable book to have written. There were just a couple of thoughts. One was, it just occurred to me how helpful the Brahma Viharas are in terms of kind of taking us off that kind of axis of hope, despair, which actually isn't helpful because they are just views, and I see how myself and other people can kind of ricochet between those. And actually, it feels so important to find something that can kind of contain us more steadily, support us more steadily than that kind of hope, despair thing that it's quite easy to get kind of caught in. So that was one reflection. And the other thing that really struck me during the meditation was just you talking about the balance between taking in nourishment and giving out nourishment. And I kind of never quite thought about it in exactly that kind of way. And I just found it really lovely and helpful to think about, the creation, the working on creating that balance, just a really nice way of framing something. So yeah, just two little things, and thank you.
Oh, thank you, Karuna Vacha. Yes, this balance. So I came across this phrase, can we fill as we pour? And I first heard it from Lama Rod Owens, who's a wonderful teacher in the States. And so this phrase really, really struck with me, sat with me, and we cannot pour unless we fill. And if if the vessel is blocked for whatever reason, and doesn't get refilled, that you know, that those patterns, those habit patterns of depleting ourselves, of exhausting ourselves, which may have many different roots, culturally, socially, whole reasons why they're there. But you know, that is burnout, that is exhaustion, that is depletion, and it's so ever present in our societies, you know, in frontline healthcare and education, and you know, myriad ways, which I'm sure you're all really aware of. And like you say, yes, that bouncing between the binaries of hope and despair, of denialism and alarmism. And how do we also bring compassion to that? You know, I can feel in myself sometimes that, you know, that bouncing between the two, and that recognition, oh, here I am again, bouncing back and forth. And what else is here? Like you say, that steadiness of the container. And the Brahma Viharas, I mean, the Dharma teachings offer us so many different creative frameworks. The Brahma Viharas is just one. I mean, the Four Truths or Tasks are also another really valuable one in these times. But yes, finding a container that is bigger than, you know, just me on my own trying to do my thing. So important. And again, that brings in anatta, interdependence, and how do we really broaden out and tune in, you know, in whatever ways we can, to the boundlessness that is spoken of as this, you know, just the inherent essence of the Brahma Viharas, that they are boundless. Other questions, reflections? Just going to see if I can bring up some of, because the book is illustrated by Emma Burley, and I wanted to show you some more of her images. I'm just going to see if I can share some of those. To finish off with. So this was that. This is where I, where my system crashed. The different and these are just some of the ways in which the Brahma Viharas can interconnect, and in which compassion could be sustained by all of them. This is the seal pup, and this is one of the images in the pausing chapter. So the pausing chapter has a lot about rest. And is really inspired by teachers and practitioners that I have had the privilege to be with, who really combine contemplative practice with engaged practice. And you may know, you know, many people like this. It's been a real inspiration to me that you know, for example, on visiting a retreat that combined olive harvest in the West Bank, in the occupied West Bank and in Palestine, with contemplative practice, I really got the sense of how essential and vital it was to stop, to pause in the midst of that, you know, often extreme sense of urgency and emergency, and of course in these days, catastrophe. But to be with people, this was a few years ago now, who, you know, invited us to, in the midst of the harvest, to take a day to, you know, practice quietly together, was such a revelation into how kind of the inner activism and the outer activism can inform each other. And this is one of the images for the ground of friendliness, tuning into the ground of friendliness beneath us. This is one for joy. Some beautiful images of birds, particularly in the chapter on joy. This is for compassion in community. And again, that sense of being, of something really tuning into the collective, because we can often again get that sense of like, it's just me on my own. And that isolation can be extremely disempowering and toxic. And again, finding the steadiness, the equanimity of being rooted in the ground, but also our branches stretching out and being with others. Thank you. I think we've just got a few minutes left. If there's any more questions, any more comments, reflections. Yeah, it's really wonderful. It's unusual to find illustrated books for grown-ups. I mean, apart from the whole wonderful world of graphic novels, but so it was quite, I think, you know, quite a experimental step for Windhorse to have to publish such a illustrated book with all these images, but it feels like that really is congruent with the creativity of the Brahma Viharas and how we cultivate them in our lives. And the creativity of our practice, you know, bhavana, word often translated as metta, as meditation, bringing into being or discovering, you know, discovering or uncovering something. So really tapping into that. The Nap Ministry, that gets referenced in the book. Yeah, wonderful. The work of Trisha Hersey, who's got a book out. Do I have some guided meditations online? There are some on Dharma Seed and some on my website. And also the book has guided meditations that you can download from the Windhorse website. And I just wonder, Zach, if you've got the link there for the book, if you could pop it in the chat. That would be great. Or I can pop it in. Thank you. We've got a couple of minutes left, so I wondered about reading one of the poems to finish, if that would be okay. One of my poems. And it is... it's a poem that I wrote a few years ago. In response to quite a tragic happening, which was that in 2016, in June 2016, the British MP Joe Cox was killed by a white supremacist. And a year later, there was lots and lots of community events called the Great Get Together, to marking the anniversary of her death and celebrating her life and legacy. And I was invited to read poetry at one of these events. So I wrote a sonnet, and it was partly inspired by the scientific evidence that all known living organisms evolved from a common ancestor. And it's called In Common, which references her maiden speech in Parliament that included the words, "We are far more united and have far more in common than that which divides us." In common, first breath, last, a pulse. Put your fingers here on my throat where each beats felt. Strangers or enemies, we breathe each other's air, and then the trees will keep on breathing when we've left. 4 billion years since that first chemical reaction in the mud, and still we share some DNA with all that moves, is sensitive, takes in, gives out. So ununique our flinch or flight from threat, the restless mix of wanting and not wanting to arrive, to sit in peace. in common. Stomachs churn, the pull of dread, hate's easy reflex, the urge to say, them, us. And yet, our fierce capacity to break at children's deaths, to fling ourselves at life, raise millions in an hour to run, to give up everything we have for what we love. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you for your presence, your practice. Take good care, and thanks again to Shanti Garba and all the organisers.
Thank you very much, River. So just a moment to unmute and thank River in whatever way you wish to, and then we'll close.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.